we are going to discuss here about UPSC Civil Services Examination. Many students are having dream in their mind to become IFS officer or IAS officer like that. Say whatever you want to become here, that IAS, IFS or like that, then the examination is only one, that is called as UPSC Civil Services Examination. So we are going to discuss here about UPSC Civil Services Examination. That means examination for becoming IAS officer, then IFS officer, IPS and so on. So first thing, let us understand what is UPSC. It's a Union Public Service Commission. That commission is there and that commission is conducting out these examinations for selecting out various civil servants. So we are going to discuss in this entire seminar various questions. Question wise, I am going to discuss the points, and then if any unsolved question is there, you are free to write in this video that whatever your doubts, or even you can call the number which is appearing over here. On this number you may call and ask if it is possible for us. We are going to answer. What is eligibility to appear for UPSC Civil Services Examination? Now, basic thing is that you must be minimum graduate. Minimum is important word here. So you must minimum graduate from UGC recognized university. So this is first criteria. When exam is there, say for example you are appearing for examination of 2020, then on 1st August 2020 your age must be 21 year complete minimum. Those students are completing out their graduation examination, they can apply. But those who are appearing for examination, they also can apply for this examination. Only condition is that your age limit should be there, as we discussed, that is of 21 years old. So then if you are appearing for graduation examination, then also you can apply for this examination. It is not necessary that graduation is completed, but the reason is that when you are appearing for prelim, it is just coming around your finishing of graduation. But then onwards, you have to provide your original documents in latter phase if you are getting success in prelim and mains. And therefore, it is recommended that when you are at graduation level, that means last year of graduation, then also you can apply for this examination, provided that your age, minimum age should be 21 years old on 1st of August of the year in which you are applying. In case of eligibility, age-wise, we discussed that minimum age is required, that is 21 years complete. But we didn't discuss about maximum age, upper age limit. And therefore, here I am giving answer that what is upper age limit for attending this examination. So obviously, a bit complicated one. Let me clarify point-wise. So first point, if you belong to open category, then upper age limit is of 32 years. So from 21 years to 32 years, in that you can attend this examination. If you belong to OBC category, then age limit is relaxed. 3 years relaxation is there from open category, and so it is 35 years old. Whereas if you belong into SC category, then 5 years relaxation is there, and then upper age limit goes to 37. So basically, we can keep in mind that upper age limit for open category is 32, and for other categories, relaxations that is given in the provision. The question is that how many times you can attempt this examination? Say how many times you attempt for 10th standard or 12th standard. Maximum students get clear of this examination in one attempt only. but this UPSC civil services examinations are not that easy. I'm not upbraiding you, but not that easy. And so they have kept various attempt depending upon your category again. So if you belong into open category, then you can attempt this examination for 6 times. So it is not 1 or 2, it's 6 times you can attempt for this examination if you belong into open category. For OBC, the criteria is relaxed to 9 attempts, and for SC category it is unlimited attempt. Don't consider unlimited means till old age, but till you become that 37. So 21 to 37 all attempt if one wants can get. So these are number of attempts for this examination. The question is that how we consider number of attempt. So if you are entering in examination hall, then it is considered as attempt. If you are giving blank paper also, but your signature is there, then it is considered as you have attempted that examination. If you are only applying, then it is not considered as your attempt. What is the pattern of UPSC civil services examination? Now, I am recording this video in 2019. You must have observed my previous videos also. From 2011, my videos are there on YouTube. So time to time certain changes are made, not by me, by UPSC, and therefore I have to change. So now I am telling you what is the current pattern of that is there in 2019. And then for a while I will go back. Before 2010, what was the pattern, that also we are going to discuss. So here, this examination, or this process rather, instead of examination, I should call this is as process. This process is divided into 3 parts. That is, the first part, preliminary examination. Second part, mains examination. Third part, interview. Wrongly called as interview, properly called as personality test. So, I am revising again. It is preliminary test, then mains and interview, or that is called as personality test. After selection, further training is provided, that we can call as fourth stage, but I am not concerned with that. So we are concerned here till personality test or interview. So I am revising again. We have to get through this circuit. The first one is of preliminary examination, then mains, and then interview. Now I am talking about preliminary test. So many students are having dream, or their parents rather are having dream to become our son or daughter should become IAS officer. Many students, they have their own dream that I must become IAS officer or like that. So like that many people are there, but the commission wants eligible candidate, and therefore we are using this as a filter. So preliminary examination is something like the filter that is selecting out eligible candidate for mains examination. So prelim examination is divided into 2 parts. I am revising again. I am talking of prelim. I am not yet coming to the mains examination. I am focusing only on prelim right now. Prelim examination is constituting of 2 papers, paper 1 and paper 2. Each paper is of 200 marks, but objective in nature. So here, objective means you have to go for multiple choice. So out of 4, you have to select any one. So like that things are there, and ultimately your answer paper will be something like this, that circles are there in front of you, and you have to dark the circle only. So no need to write anything on that paper, only your seat number, etc. But ultimately answers, you have to just darken the circle. That is preliminary examination. So paper 1 and paper 2. mains is divided into again different papers. But what is difference here? That mains is all a paper you have to write it down. Only those successful candidate who are able to pass eligibility test, they are able to give mains examination. So it is not that everybody, those who are appearing for prelim, they are going for mains. Say for example, if 1000 is selection number, all category, that is IAS, IPS and all that, some 33 categories are there. So all these categories, seats are there around 1000. Then what is the criteria? They are selecting 1:3 ratio for interview. That means 3000 students will be selected for interview. If 3000 students are selected for interview, then for mains examination, they are going to select approximately 10,000 to 14,000 students, approximately. So cutoff will be set that mains should be given by 10,000 to 14,000 students. And like that, cutoff marks are set. Cutoff marks are considered only from paper 1. Paper 2 marks are called as qualifying marks. Qualifying marks means what? You have to score minimum 66 marks out of 200. So if you are scoring out 66 marks, then only we can consider marks of your paper 1. If you are scoring 200 marks out of 200, then only we are going to consider only marks of paper 1. Whatever marks you scored in paper 2, they are not coming in actual counting process. Alright. Then your cutoff will be given on only marks of paper 1. But reverse case, suppose you are scoring out 200 out of 200, just impossible, but say, if you are scoring out 200 out of 200 in paper 1, but you are not able to score 66 marks in paper 2 minimum, then you are simply rejected. And so, qualifying marks means you must score minimum 66 marks in paper 2. So, this is basic thing. Once you passed out prelim, then you are appearing for mains, where essay writing is important paper, and apart from essay writing, you have to give 4 different papers, that is of general studies, and then one paper is there that is called as optional subject. So in short, total 6 papers you have to appear for mains examination. All papers are written paper. Okay, prelim is objective, mains is writing out. And then the only qualified students after mains, they are selected for personality test. And after personality test, whatever your score from personality test and your score from mains, that is added out, and toppers are selected. So is it very clear for you? That preliminary marks are not considered into counting of your score. Your score is counted only on basis of mains examination plus marks obtained in personality test. So that is the important thing. Depending upon score, reports of your personality test, you are categorized for IAS, IPS or whatever the other fields are there in that field. What is the nature of UPSC Civil Services preliminary examination? Now, in this part, we are focusing only on prelim examination. Prelim examination is divided into 2 papers, paper 1 and paper 2. Paper 1 is actually we are considering for counting of mark. For cutoff mark, paper 1 is important. Paper 2 is considered as qualifying level. That means you have to score 66 marks out of 200, then you are qualified. Your marks are not considered into score. So your cutoff will be of out of 200, because paper 1 is of 200 mark, paper 2 is also of 200 mark, but your cutoff will not consider over there. It's clear. Now we are going to discuss about paper 1 first. Paper 1 is comprising of all possible knowledge in this world. That's why we are calling it as general study. General world. I am really afraid of general world. So you are aware when Muhammad Ghaznavi, those who are history students, they are aware that when Muhammad Ghaznavi went to Somnath, he ordered general slaughter over there. When person is going into operation theater, the question is that where local anesthesia is given or general anesthesia is given. So like that, general study I am afraid in, because it is comprising of all possible things under the roof. Whatever knowledge we have, usually we are considering 10 plus 2 level knowledge. It is not that hard also, but not that easy also. I don't want to afraid you, but I don't want to motivate you in this way that it's very easy, everybody can come. No. So if you are having hard working ability, then only you can try this examination, because you have to study a lot. Let me clarify. You have to study physics, chemistry, biology. Three subjects are there from science. And particularly saying that physics, chemistry and biology, that is from science side. Geography is there. We can consider it from art side. Along with geography and combination of physics, chemistry and biology, another subject is there, that is called as environmental science. So it is also there. So I am revising physics, chemistry, biology, geography, environmental science. Then subject from arts side, but named as science, that is political science, or rather we are calling here this as Indian polity. Then economics, history. Now we are splitting out history as Indian history and Indian freedom struggle, that is national freedom struggle. So two subjects we have to consider as history part only. And we may ask question that you studied history, you studied geography, national freedom struggle, but what is use of all that if present knowledge is not there? And then obviously I have to think of the most important subject right now here, that is current affairs. So all these subjects are there under this roof. I am revising physics, chemistry, biology, environmental science, geography, then history, national freedom struggle, Indian polity, economics and current affairs. All these subjects you have to study in paper 1. No doubt paper 1 is objective. Now the thing is that focus on examination. It is not necessary, say in academics you are very clear that this subject you have to study for these many marks. Or rather, in subject, we are aware that this is the chapter where, for example, X chapter is there for 5 marks, Y chapter is there for 3 marks. So like that, wattage is there. But in case of this civil services examination, prelim examination, they are not providing anything like that. They may ask more questions on environmental science. May be possible they may not ask even a single question on nuclear physics. So like that, any question they can ask here in this thing. So there is no particular wattage for particular subject. So you should not consider that, okay, this year may be possible I am not studying out science or PCB, physics, chemistry, biology I am considering as option, and I will go for other subject. May be possible in that year paper will be focused in science area. You may say that, okay, environmental science I am keeping aside, but may be possible maximum focus will be there on environmental science or current affair. And like that, you are not very clear here about this. Paper 2. Now we are switching over to paper 2. Paper 2 is considering all good things. Say, my favorite paper, if you ask, that is of paper 2. It's very nice paper. And an officer must have knowledge of paper 2. What I feel personally, not UPSC feel. And so it is of comprehension skill. That means, what is your grasping power? What is your eligibility to grasp from given content and able to answer? So paper 2, that is having comprehension skill, then logical reasoning, analytical reasoning, data interpretation, Now, data interpretation is most critical thing. Many people and officers also are not able to read out even a graph. Many times this happened, and therefore it is actually necessary thing that at officer level, this minimum eligibility you must have. So that is data interpretation. Then simple arithmetics. And what is the most important that officer should have? That is decision making and problem solving skill along with communication skills. So all these things are there in paper 2. Obviously communication skill means verbal and non-verbal communication and all that is included, that is there in paper 2. In 2011, this paper 2 was important paper that was introduced. But by few years, students started opposing this paper, and ultimately this is democracy, so paper 2 made qualifying. But because of that, what exactly happened, I want to tell that qualifying marks from paper 2, to obtain that qualifying marks is not that difficult task. For a normal person, if you ask to run 100 meter in 10 minutes, then it's quite easy. Run, instead of that, I should say walk 100 meters in 10 minutes. So it's that easy. But if I am saying that, okay, within 15 seconds, I'm not talking of 11 and 10 seconds, within 15 seconds you have to cross 100 meter, then it is difficult. So like that, when paper 2 was considered under scoring subject, then it was difficult because you have to solve 80 questions in 120 minutes, that is 2 hours, and that was difficult. But now you have sufficient time. Actually, you have option and option and option. You can check out nearly 50% paper is focused on comprehension. If you are eliminating that, then also with decision making, problem solving, logical reasoning, analytical reasoning, arithmetics, data interpretation and all that, you can score 66 marks is quite easy. Each question carries 2.5 marks. Obviously, negative marking is there. Yes. That is called as 0.33. Or simply, if your 3 questions answers are wrong, then they are deducting out marks of one question straight away. That means you are going to lose all 3 questions mark, plus as a penalty, they will charge you penalty, and one question mark that will be deducted from your score. That means suppose you have scored 20 marks and now you lost 3 questions. Each question is carrying out 2.5 mark, then you lost all that 3 questions mark plus your score was initially 20, from that they will deduct 2.5 marks because single question carries 2.5 marks in paper 2. In paper 1, 100 questions are there. That means each question carries 2 marks. So if it is in paper 1, then they will deduct 2 marks for your 3 mistakes. So that is the criteria of prelim. And therefore, now it's very clear for you that you have to focus more on paper 1. But you should not ignore paper 2, because if you are not able to score 66 marks in paper 2, then whatever your score of paper 1, they are not going to consider. And therefore, you have to focus more on paper 1, but we should not ignore paper 2. Otherwise, we are not able to reach till the target. Alright, so this is about prelim examination. Importance of preliminary examination. So this is important point. Many students are having misconceptions in the mind. They want to prepare for mains examination. Blindly they are following that we want to prepare for mains examination. Now from past 10 years I am in this field of actual education here. Various students are asking doubts about mains examination. They don't have any doubt about preliminary examination. I admire their confidence that they have taken in granted that I am going to pass prelim and I am having doubt in mains. But from SY or FY level, students are discussing about language, which language I have to select for mains. So this is really hopeless part. You should have knowledge, but it is not that you should worry always about mains examination. Alright, so in order to reach there, you must have very good score in prelim examination. Prelim examination is really, we can say here, a tough competition. For example, approximately 10 lakh to 15 lakh students are trying their luck. And out of that, very few, that means around 10 to 14,000 students, they will get selected for mains examination. So selection rate is very, very, very less. And therefore, in order to reach to mains examination, you must first prepare preliminary examination thoroughly. So here, my focus is there that first, the importance of preliminary examination you should consider. Prepare for preliminary examination, then obviously you'll get time for mains. Many students are worrying that there is very small gap, time gap between prelim examination and mains examination, and then I will not able to fulfill my study for mains. So it is not that way, because that commission planned in nice way, this everything. And so what they say, that no special preparation is required for mains examination, except whatever the optional subject is there. And therefore, keep in mind that your focus should be on preliminary examination. In case of preliminary examination, you have to first clear out paper 2. And so, my suggestion is that first focus on paper 2. Try to get logical reasoning sums, analytical reasoning sums, data interpretation, simple arithmetics, English vocabulary, and all this part, whatever there is in paper 2. So, get assurity that consecutively in 3 mock tests, you are able to score at least 70-75 marks. It is not that difficult. Again, I am telling you, to score 70-75 marks in paper 2 is not that difficult. But if you are getting this confidence, then start preparation of paper 1. Paper 1, you have to consider all subjects are my subject only. Many students are having concept in mind that I am belonging to art side. So science is not my cup of tea. I am trying to get option. No. When you are appearing for this type of examination, you should consider that all subjects are my subject only. And I am able to do that. Many times this happens that at school level, you are having some liking or disliking to the subject. Sometimes teacher's role is also important. Because I don't like that teacher, I don't like that subject. Like that, in early childhood, certain concepts are developed. Now you are grown up. And therefore consider that now I can able to get knowledge of each and every subject. If not in school days, then now I will get that knowledge. And therefore, my suggestion is that try to study all subjects deeply. And obviously, examination practice is important. It is not that only you are reading out and getting knowledge. Yes, it is first step, but whether you are able to implement that knowledge, and that can be achieved only by appearing for various tests, then only it is possible. So that test knowledge is important here, and therefore what is the ideal way you can prepare for preliminary examination is that you have to attend various tests, that is, we are calling as mock tests. They are categorized. For example, unit test. Unit test means particular chapters are there. Say, for example, I am teaching history. So, in history, I will teach Mughal history. So, from arrival of Taimur Lung or Chengiz Khan, rather than that, because real Mughal history begins with arrival of Chengiz Khan on horizon of India. Then onwards, like Targhi Khan, Kutluk Khwaja, Taimur Lung, all that, precursors we can say. And then Sayyid dynasty, then onwards Babur to Aurangzeb, that is first segment, and second segment Aurangzeb onwards till Bahadur Shah Jafar. So like that I am making segment, and each segment I am studying out. For example, that first segment from Chengiz Khan to arrival of Babur. So this is first segment, test will be there on that segment. Second segment from Babur to Aurangzeb, test will be there from that segment. Third segment from Aurangzeb onwards to Bahadur Shah Jafar, that is the last Mughal emperor. So that is the third segment, and then you are thoroughly preparing for that. So like that you have to study. Is it clear? So test pattern is important, and then obviously mock test, like entire prelim you have to appear twice or thrice. You will get idea that maybe possible not a single question will ask from Mughal history, though you have prepared, but they may not ask any single question on Mughal history. Maybe possible they can ask 10 questions on Mughal history only, and for that purpose actual practice or mock test of prelim, that mock prelims, they are really important, and this way you can study prelim examination at depth.